This video is sponsored by brilliant.org, and it's the second video in a mini-series about linear algebra. Click here to watch the first one on vectors and bases for vector spaces. This video is about matrices. When I first met a matrix, it was in a textbook question. It asked me to put a bunch of numbers to do with a bakery sales into an array. I was very confused. It took me a long, long time to really understand that matrices have nothing to do with bakeries, and just the same way that writing a vector as a column of numbers is just a shorthand, writing a matrix as an array of numbers is a shorthand too. This is what matrices really are. They are linear transformations. Okay, so let me explain. Remember vectors from last time? Well, imagine you have some vector and you want to transform it into some other vector instead. In fact, say you have some whole vector space, let's say all the vectors in 2D space, and you want to transform them into vectors in another or the same space, for example, vectors in 3D space. Then a transformation is something that just eats a vector from your initial space and spits out a vector in your new space. A matrix is a transform, but a very specific type called a linear transform, which is something that respects linear combinations. Let's say I have two vectors. I'm going to apply this matrix to each of them, and that will transform them in some way. Then I can make a linear combination of the result. But what if I decided to do this linear combination first, and then put the resulting vector into the matrix? A linear transformation is one when these two processes result in the same final vector. In other words, you can put your two vectors into the matrix and then take a particular linear combination of them, or you can take that linear combination of them first and then apply the matrix. Either way, you're going to get the same result. To see if you've understood this, I want you to figure out if the following transformations are linear or not. The first is a transformation that takes a 2D vector and then just multiplies it by length 3. The second is like this. First, draw a line through the origin, then take any vector in 2D, say this one, and draw a perpendicular from that line to the tip of the vector. The new vector is on the line. So are these two linear transformations? Think about the answer and then put it in the poll in the corner. Remember, committing to an answer really helps you learn. Okay, so the answer might surprise you, but they're both linear. To see this, take the first one, take any two vectors, and apply the transformation to them, and then make a linear combination of them. This is clearly the same as if you make the linear combination of them and then multiply the result by 3. The second one is a bit trickier, but the easiest way to see it is, first draw the two vectors. Then notice these vectors are equal to these two perpendicular vectors added together. When you apply the transform to them, what it does is it cuts off this bit. Then if you add them, you get this. But if instead you'd added the original vectors first, it would be like adding all four bits first, which you can group up like this. Now, if we apply the transformation, it cuts off this bit, and as you can see, we have the same thing in both cases. Kind of neat, right? But here's the really nice thing about linear transformations. Imagine you have a linear transformation from some initial space to some other space, and you have an arbitrary basis for your initial space. Now, let's suppose that we know exactly what the linear transformation does to the basis vectors. This is in fact enough to figure out what it does to the entire space. To see why, say you have some other vector in the initial space. You can write it as a linear combination of the basis vectors. In 2D, remember you do this by using a grid. Okay, so once you finally got that linear combination, if you apply a linear transformation to it, you can see by linearity that you only needed to know what happened to the basis vectors to compute this thing. So now we get to writing a matrix as an array. What you'll see is the first column represents what happens to your first basis vector, the second what happens to your second basis vector, etc. Remember how to write vectors as columns in some basis? It's a shorthand for writing out this linear combination of basis vectors. Then clearly, the basis vectors are written like this. Say I apply my linear transformation to the first basis element and I get this column vector, and I do this for each basis vector. As I said before, this is everything I need to know about a linear transformation, so I want to store this information compactly. So I store it in a matrix like this. And that is all a matrix really is. It's shorthand where, just like in the case of vectors written as columns, the basis is hidden. But the basis is super important, so this array of numbers only represents a linear transformation as long as you're clear about what the basis is. Now I can explain what it means to multiply a matrix by a vector. It's not about multiplication at all. All it means is you apply the linear transformation that this matrix represents to the vector that this represents. As we saw, this is equal to this big sum, which you might recognize as the rule for multiplying matrices and vectors. To see if you've got all this, see if you can come up with a matrix for the following linear transformation. It takes the first basis vector and does nothing to it, and takes the second basis vector and deletes it. Another way of thinking of that is, it takes the second basis vector to the zero vector, the vector with no length. Pause the video now and try and come up with a matrix in this basis. So hopefully you've had a think. The answer is this. By the way, your matrices definitely don't need to be square. The dimension of the matrix tell you about the dimension of the vectors it eats versus the dimension of the vectors it spits out. In this example, the matrix takes 3D vectors and gives back 2D ones. Then its shape has to be this, because it has three rows representing what the matrix does to the three basis vectors of the initial space, and two columns because each of the basis vectors becomes a 2D vector. If you've followed everything so far, then matrix multiplication is going to be really simple to explain. You know how when you first meet matrix multiplication, they throw this crazy formula at you. Then they expect you to act shocked when you find out that if you call this insane thing multiplication, then A times B doesn't equal B times A. There is a much, much easier way to understand matrix multiplication. Let's look at an example first. Imagine you want to transform some vectors. First, you want to rotate them by 90 degrees in the plane. Then you want to project them onto this line like we did earlier. Both of these are linear, so call the matrix representing these transformations in some basis A and B. Then here's a question. Is it the same thing to do the projection first and then the rotation? I can tell you it's not, but I want you to pause the video now and think of a vector that would come out different if you do the projection first or if you do it second. If you can think of one, say so in the poll here. Okay, so there are many options, but here's a vector that works. If a vector starts on the line and you apply A, it gets rotated to here. But then you apply B to the result and you project it down, though in this case, it immediately becomes the zero vector. But if you did it the other way around, when you apply B, nothing happens, and then when you apply A, it gets rotated to here. So clearly doing A then B is different from doing B then A. So here's the big secret. When we write BA, the linear transformation that we're talking about is the one where you do A first, then B. That's all it means. And as we've just seen, order matters, so this is clearly different from the linear transformation AB, since in that case, you swap the order. So the statement AB doesn't equal BA is actually blindingly obvious once you understand the meaning of these things, and really shouldn't be presented as a startling fact. So why does this lovely idea of composing maps lead to the awfulness that is the matrix multiplication formula? Well, actually, once you understand it, the formula really isn't ugly at all. Let me show you what I mean by taking the case where A and B are 2x2 matrices. How would we try and write AB as a matrix in a particular basis? Well, let's just follow our own rules. We need to find out what AB does to each of the basis vectors. Let's do the first one. Well, when we apply B, we get the first column of B by definition. But then we apply A and we get B11 times the first column of A plus B21 times the second column. This result is our first column of AB. Do the same for the second basis vector, and here is the formula. See, matrices aren't so painful after all. Okay, so it's homework time. First, not all size matrices can be multiplied together. Think about it in terms of them representing transformations from one space to another, and figure out which size matrices can be multiplied, and explain why in the comments. Second, and this is a multiple choice one, consider a transformation that takes a 3D vector and adds some fixed vector k to it. Say k is the vector 7, 3, 3. Is this a linear transformation or not? Third, imagine you have a matrix A that multiplies the first basis vector by 2 and the second basis vector by 6. How do you write A in this basis? As you will have noticed, these questions are from brilliant.org, who are sponsoring this video. I said this last time, but I think linear algebra is just a topic that you can't understand without doing examples. If you try and understand the topic through just learning a bunch of formulas or theorems, you just won't be able to get all the subtleties involved. I found that when I went through Brilliant's course, which has really well-designed examples, I remembered a bunch of tricky little points that I'd forgotten about, and it got me really comfortable with doing actual calculations again, since I don't do a lot of those anymore. You can sign up to either a monthly or a yearly membership and access this course and many others on their website. If you follow the link on the screen or in the description, you can get 20% off your yearly membership. Thanks for watching these linear algebra videos. It's one of my favorite fields of math, so I love teaching it because it feels like I'm learning it all again myself. Anyway, the next one will be linked here in 2 weeks, so subscribe if you'd like to see it when that's out.